minutes for your presentation. I'm going to give you the opportunity for a few minutes to tell us something that we cannot glean from your application about yourself, because we've all thoroughly read your application, and then the committee will have some questions for you, so the floor is yours.
Thank you. I did actually write a little mini biography about myself that I put in my application, and I noticed last night when I was reviewing it that I was talking in the third person. I'm not crazy. I don't normally talk about myself in the third person. Where that came from was I ran the first circuit court back in 2016. Ran a campaign and utilized that as a kind of a biography of myself. If I gave an opening, I would basically be regurgitating what's in that biography. And since it's such a short interview of 15 minutes, I prefer to take questions.
Perfect, perfect. We'll start with you, Andrew.
Yes, sir. In response to questions 46 and 49B in your application packet, you stated, and I appreciate you representing law enforcement officers. You mentioned you do that, and I did that for 10 years. You taught them at Eastern Florida State College regarding the Fourth Amendment. Since they're extremely well-versed in the Fourth Amendment, I was wondering if you could expound for us what you discussed in that presentation.
It was interesting. I was asked to do it a couple times. It was usually done by Judge Kenning. He used to teach that class, and Patrick Lepore also taught the class. When they were unable to do it, they asked, would I do it? Generally, what I would do, and quite frankly, I knew most law enforcement officers that were there. There weren't, they were seasoned law enforcement officers. They weren't, you know, going through class to become a law enforcement officer. So what I typically would do is I would take two cases, examples of motions to suppress, one that was granted and one that had been denied. And kind of go through why that particular one was granted, why that was a violation of the Fourth Amendment, and then with one that was denied, why it was denied. But that was basically what we talked about. About two examples of actual motions to suppress.
I'm sure they were enthralled with the granted one. Yeah.
Well, ironically, I didn't know this, but one of the officers that I had. The motion to suppress that was granted, that officer was actually in the court, in the audience. I didn't realize it at the time. But that, yeah, that was a bit embarrassing for myself when I realized he was there.
Thank you. David?
So most of your experience has been in criminal court scenes, yes. And so you're a public defender for 7 years now? And,
yes.
And since then, about the same in private practice. It appears, from reading all this, that the majority of your private practice is also criminal, but you dabble a little civil and family, is that right?
Correct.
Could you describe the civil litigation that you've done, since it's a smaller component?
Yes.
And the family work that you've done, also whether that's active litigation, family court, say divorce or dependency or something like that, or and then also why you've chosen to focus mostly on criminal as opposed to sort of expanding into civil and family areas.
Okay, I'll start with the last part of your question there. When I was in law school at Seattle University, my intent was to go into international law, something like that. I wasn't really interested in the litigation per se. I ended up taking a tribal advocacy class, which I loved. I got hooked. And my professor was actually a practicing attorney that did a lot of high-profile trials. So we would go and watch them. A lot of the trials he was doing were criminal-type trials. And what fascinated me about the criminal side of it was the Constitution, the amendments to the Constitution, the Fourth Amendment, Fifth Amendment. That's kind of what drew me to criminal defense initially. When I realized I wanted to do litigation, I wanted to get back to Brevard County, first of all, because I consider Brevard my home. So when I graduated in December, I took the Washington Bar in February passed. I flew out here, I took the July Florida Bar and passed. I immediately set interviews with Mr. Trettis, the public attorney's office, and with Wayne Holmes at the state attorney's office. Blaze had me first, the first interview with Blaze, and he offered me a job on the spot, so I took it. That's how I kind of got into the criminal defense field. I had to cancel my interview with Wayne, because I already accepted the job with the place. When I went into private practice, obviously I started right into criminal defense, because that was my thing. Expanded that into federal criminal defense. slowly started doing dependency cases. A lot of my clients had a criminal charge, sometimes ended up with a dependency type case. That's how I got into doing dependency cases, Chapter 39 cases. I consider that civil, but it's kind of a mixture of juvenile law as well. I also started back into doing delinquency, which is juvenile, that is criminal. Started doing a lot of injunctions, which is quasi-civil, a little bit of criminal. Then my wife joined me about a year or two after I opened the firm. She wanted to do family law, so we started doing family law. That's what she does 100% right now is family law. I do assist in a lot of family law cases. I've done a lot of hearings. Over the years, I have gotten phone calls for different types of areas of law. Typically, if I don't practice in an area of law, I will refer to a different attorney. There's a couple of civil cases that I put in my application that stand out. One was the Japanese.
Steve, I don't mean to cut you off, but we've got to move additional questions.
Is that okay? Yes, thank you.
Phil?
Morning, Steve.
Good morning.
Thank you for coming and applying. What do you believe is the strongest quality or characteristic that you would bring to the bench if you were selected?
Probably my temperament. And my temperament, my experience, my legal experience, my life experiences. I didn't follow the traditional route of high school, college, law school. I graduated college and I worked for about 8 years before I went to law school. So I bring all that to the table. And I think what makes a good judge is a balance of a good temperament, experience, intelligence, and common sense as well, I think is important.
Thank you.
Don?
Good morning. I thoroughly enjoyed reading your mini biography, so I'm going to ask you, with that life experience, and you referenced that also, that is something as an additional layer of what you can bring to the circuit bench. Could you just expound on that for me, to let me know what that wide global diversity offers?
Yes, ma'am. I grew up in Woodland Beach. I left Cocoa Beach when I was about 11 to go to Japan. And obviously, much different then. Brevard is much different now than it was then. I've noticed that Brevard has grown dramatically. The population's increasing. I see more people from different countries, ethnicities that have moved into Brevard County. And I think that's just going to continue, particularly with the space program. For example, currently I have a few clients that are from Vietnam. So I think in that respect that we're going to see more and more people from other countries in our core system, in the world.
Judicial elections are no measure of one's quality as a lawyer,
right,
nor their ability to serve as a judge.
Absolutely.
But we do have recent data on how the voters view you. And if that's an issue that we discuss in our deliberation, I want to give you the opportunity to discuss with us why we should nominate you when the voters thought otherwise recently.
It's a good question. To kind of give some background to that, I got into the campaign late. I announced in February, but really didn't get started until April. My opponent had run in 2014, lost, continued running, and prevailed in 2016. Part of my problem was that I got it too late. I think if I'd gotten it earlier, the results may have been different. Also, the dynamics of elections have changed, and they continue to change, because the mail-in ballots are slowly increasing in number. In 2016, the mail-in ballots made up about 50% of the votes, and then the early voting has been extended to almost a week, and that's about 25% of the votes. So the actual election day, only about 25% of the votes were cast. That's something I didn't know, because I'd never run a campaign before. I know that now. I know all the mistakes I made. I'm confident that if I ran a campaign again, that they would be successful. Seminole, the thing about circuit court, you have to run in Seminole. You have to campaign in Seminole County. And I knew nothing about Seminole County. It is, I might as well be on Mars when I'm in Seminole County. I don't know the streets, I don't know the cities, I don't really know anybody over there. I made some good connections while I was over there that helped me out tremendously, like John Jones, who's a personal injury attorney over there. He helped me out. And then when you're campaigning and you're going to all these hobnob events, you end up in contact with a lot of other candidates that are running for legislative positions or, you know, clerk of courts or whatever. And so I've made those contacts. A lot of those people have been elected. I still am friends with them. So I've been able to maintain my contacts in Seminole County, because you can't win a circuit court seat in Brevard without carrying Seminole County. So a lot of candidates forget to focus on Seminole County. But based on my, because I did the campaign and I know made all these contacts over there, I think it definitely gives me an edge.
Well, it's not, I'm really not asking about 2020.
Okay.
I mean, the governor's office is going to sit there and say, the voters have made a choice here. Now, it's not dispositive, but I need you to address that with us, why we should overlook an election result from 2 years ago.
I'm not sure I can answer that, because I can't get in the heads of the voters. All I can tell you is that I believe that had I gotten in the race earlier, because judicial races really come down to name recognition. And when you have an opponent that's run for 3 years, and their name is out there, their name has been on the ballot before, they have a distinct edge. If I probably started a year in advance, I think it would take it.
Okay. Thank you. Jeff?
I don't have any questions.
Thank you.
Yeah. Steve, I just have a question for you. If you could pick what division you would go into, and you know the various divisions of Vermont County, which division would you not pick? In other words, judges get to pick oftentimes.
What I would not pick?
Yeah.
There's really not a division that, like I said, I would not enjoy or not pick. I think one of the toughest divisions is the penitentiary court. It is typically a very emotional courtroom. There's a lot of parties involved in the penitentiary cases. You've got the guardian ad litem, you've got the DCF attorneys, you've got the caseworkers, there's all these people talking and addressing the particular case. I wouldn't mind doing the penitentiary court, because I've done it, but if I had to pick one that I wouldn't want to necessarily do, it'd probably be the penitentiary court.
And which judge, if you could, the Brevard County judges, would you model yourself after in terms of the way he or she runs their courtroom, handles attorneys, etc.?
I've been in front of every judge in this county and judges in other counties. I've kind of seen it all. I think I would probably say Jack Respond. The reason I say Jack is that he had this innate ability to keep the courtroom very calm. When they would see attorneys arguing, and he wanted to tone that down or he wanted to address it, he would very calmly say, counsel approach, here's a minute. And he would just somehow just diffuse that whole situation. He also allowed the defense attorneys and the state attorneys to work out their cases. He didn't push the docket, like some judges do. My position, and I think Jack Riesbaum recognized that, is most criminal cases do resolve on their own if you let the state defense do their job.
What time do you get into the office when you're not in court? What time do you get
usually
into?
Usually 8.
And approximately, on a monthly basis, how many orders or judgments do you prepare yourself? Primarily criminal, how many orders or judgments do you prepare?
Probably in the neighborhood of 5 or 10.
Per month?
Yeah.
For what type of cases?
Sometimes criminal cases, dependency cases, a couple family cases, some of the civil cases.
Any follow-up questions? Thank you. Appreciate
Thank you very much.
It.